Father God, thank you that you've been with us this morning. Thank you for the way that you've spoken into our lives and our situation so powerfully this morning already. And thank you for Timmy coming now, having prepared this week to come and bring your word to us. Father God, we ask now for a fresh anointing of your Holy Spirit upon Timmy, that you will fill him and clothe him with your spirit, that you will speak through him into our lives this morning. And Father God, we invite you to speak to us. We don't want to just gain information. We want to hear your word. We want to be in a different place because we've heard your word into our lives in this next 55 minutes, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, if you're standing, find a seat. God bless you.
Thank you. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before. And you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there, your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark, will not be too dark for you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. For you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this morning and for this opportunity. We thank you because you have been at work already in our lives. We thank you for the worship experience this morning. We thank you because your glory was at work, your glory is shown through. Our Lord and our God, even as we come to listen to your words, we pray that in the name of Jesus Christ that you minister to each and every one of us, Lord. Meet us, speak to us. Where we need challenging, we pray that you challenge us. Where we need encouraging, we pray that in the name of Jesus Christ that you encourage us. And that we will attain our full potentials in you and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Where is God? Where is God? You have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You have done everything by the book. You have lived by the rules. You have placed everything in his hand. despite that, every step you take come with obstacle, come with challenge. You'll not be human if you didn't ask, where is God in all of this? And this morning we'll be talking about a young man that had God's anointing upon him clearly. And despite all the difficulties that he faced, all the challenges that he faced, not knowing whether he was going to be alive the next day, he stood firm. And what I want to challenge us about this morning is about how we react in the face of hostility, in the face of challenge, in the face of things not going our ways. How will you react? How will I react? How will the church react? We live in a society, when I say society in this context, I mean in this Western society whereby dreams are attributed to having had too much cheese. Or sometimes some people will say that when you have dreams, it's just your subconscious coming to the fore when you are asleep. The society I come from, dreams are big things. Dreams tell you what is about to happen. Sometimes dreams show you where you've been. So for me, I'm coming from, if you like, the angle whereby I say dreams do come true. When I say dreams, I'm not talking about I dream or I aspire that I will have 10 million pounds in the bank account tomorrow. It will be good. It will be good. But I'm talking about when God communicates with you in your sleep. They do come true. When God gives you a dream, you know it. Obviously, it's not every dream that you give strength to. You need to be able to discern what you dream, or what the dream is about. African and many cultures, not prevalent in the West, believe in the efficacy of dreams. As I said, not because of the quantity of cheese that had been eaten, or because of any subconscious thing playing out. And today, I want us to look at how dream had impacted a gentleman. A young boy dreamt, and that changed the course of his life. Dream that God had given him. We are not going to be reading the passage, we are going to be paraphrasing and just skipping through. But when you get home, I want you to read Genesis from chapter 37 about Joseph. He had a dream of how God had made him, if you like, ruler over his family. When interpreted, ruler over his siblings. And he had the effrontery to say it out. I don't know about you. I don't know cultures that many of us have come from. But I do know cultures that many of us have come from here. But if you are a young child in a family, in a typical African family, children are to be seen and not to be heard. So for second to the last to be saying, I had a dream and all of you, my brothers, talk less of sisters and parents, are going to be serving me, are going to be bowing down before me. You can be, that child can be rest assured they are going to get a whack. But that was it. And the Bible tells us that the father took hold of this and contemplated upon it. Obviously, my senior brother, me telling him that, "Oi, old man, you are going to be bowing down for me, it's not going to go down well." So we had a situation whereby you had a family that is literally split. Virtually everyone pitted against this young man. And he didn't help himself telling tales. Do you know, Brother Reuben, yesterday, he did so, so, and so. Brother Judah, he went to so, so, and so where you asked him not to go. You know the kind of thing that we've all been children, you know the kind of thing we get up to when we were small. So the whole family was against him. At that point in time, he had everything going for him. His father was in support of him. His father indulged him. He had everything going for him. But there's a critical lesson for us as parents, for those of us that are parents here this morning. We need to be careful how we indulge children over some other children. Ah, that is my only son. Don't kill him. That is my only child. Leave him alone. Just leave her. That is my baby. I am the only one that has the right to deal with the child. There's an adage that says, only one pair gives birth to a child or knows how a child arrives. But it takes the whole family or the whole village to bring them up. He had everything. All the doors seemed opened, wide open to him. And then one day, One day, he had to go. He had to go and see his brothers. His father said, go and check on your brothers. How are they doing? Bring me a report. Take food to them. And they saw him from afar. Here comes the dreamer. Let's deal with him. If he's no longer there, who are we going to bow down to? Let's get rid of him. And how many people have seen futures terminated, have seen opportunities scuppered, have seen plans go wrong because of hatred and envy? So they set out. Let's kill him. Let's kill him. And one of the brothers said, no, don't let us do that. Let's put him in the hole or a dry well. Let's leave him there. And let's think about what to do with him. Obviously, he had his own plans to help him later. So they put him there. He was able to prevail. They put him there. Not a long while after that, some traders were passing by. This is a good opportunity. We will not have his blood on our hands. Let's sell him into slavery. Let's get rid of him. That's a good plan. That is a good plan. You are not killing blood, not on your hand. He lives. Anything happens to him, it's another person's problem. Happens to me, what question will I be asking? Where is God? Yeah, I haven't got my parents here. I haven't got my mom. I haven't got my dad. But where is God? Why is God letting them get away with this? Why is God letting them get away with this? But the Bible tells me that even in slavery, he was upright. He was upright and he shone through to people around him, to his master. And his master made him the head of his household. So as children of God, how do we let our light shine? How do we let people see that we are not just passing by and earning the money? Of course, it's right to earn money to live. But you can earn money while still serving God. Let people see God's Spirit shining you and through you. Sold into slavery. Even then, the Lord was with Joseph, and he blessed everything that Joseph oversaw. So he was promoted. And isn't that how it's supposed to be? You work faithfully, you are blessed, you serve God faithfully, he blesses you, he shields you, he opens doors for you. Sometimes, when we do everything that we are supposed to do, and I mean, when I say we are supposed to do, I mean in terms of serving God and serving our employers faithfully, things still go wrong. Things go wrong. He was serving and God was blessing him and the household that he was in. And that tells me that where children of God are at work, God not only blesses them, but blesses where they work. Blesses where they work. And the Bible tells me that this young man was very, very handsome. Not as handsome as me, though. So, his master's wife wanted him. Tried all the tricks in the books. Look here, nobody would know. Just come in. Nobody would know. Isn't that what we do sometimes? Nobody would know. No, he wouldn't do that. My master has given me right over everything in his household. I don't have any right over you. And I will not go there. Even if nobody knows. If nobody knows, God knows. If human eyes don't see me, God knows. If the person sitting at the desk next to me don't see it, God sees it. He said, no, I'm not doing it. She must be very desperate. And one day, not many people in the house, she schemed, wanted to force herself upon him. Obviously, there are no sexual discrimination laws in that time. He broke free, left his clothes with her, and ran away. And she screamed. She shouted when the master came and said, see, you have brought this slave into this household. Look what he's been trying to do to me. Imagine. Your fault. You caused it. You brought him into this household. This is the way your servant treated me. As I said earlier on, we play by the book. But things happen in life, not of our own doing, that causes us problem. But I want to assure you, I want to tell us this morning, I know you know, but I want to reiterate it this morning. God is at work. In the good, in the bad, and in the ugly, God is at work. When you think everything is being closed off against you, when you think all the roads have been closed, when you think it's only darkness, when you think there's no way out, God is at work. For the second time, his life was in danger. And if you are living today, you'll probably be singing, God's power will break every chain. So, if it were you or me, what would be our question? I have done everything according to your will. Where has it got me? Where has it got me? And it's enough to derail many a people. It's enough to say, yeah, that's it, I've had it. I've had it. I am going to do it my way. I am going to go my way. I'm going to do what pleases me. At least I'm not going to get into trouble. If I had gone in with this woman, nobody would know. But in prison, he continued the same pattern, serving, letting God's light shine through. And the chief warden made him the sub-chief warden. Because everything that he did was right, was correct, was proper. God was at work in him. And he made him do things that he did, he never checked. Because he trusted him. Because he trusted him. Then, two of the king's, Pharaoh's, servants were put in prison. And they had a dream, each. It's interesting how when we are not looking for things, we heard about how Denzel went overseas. not looking to be involved in people's life, just there in obedience to God. And God was using her. How Steve went out shopping and God used him to meet someone's needs. How our sister thought about friend she hadn't seen for a while, and God used her in that. Wherever we are, in whatever situation we are, God can use us. God can use us. When we are right on top of the mountain and everything going seemingly well, God can use us. When we are down in the death, God can use us. There's no situation that God cannot use us in. So these two people had dreams. The cupbearer had dream, and Joseph said, well, dreams, interpretation come from God. You will be restored to your post. The chief baker, I said, in 3 days, your head will be cut off. And he said, cupbearer, Mr. Cupbearer, when you have been restored, please don't forget me. Please don't forget me. I have been in this. I am the wronged person here. And did the cupbearer did he do anything? No. And you can imagine in the days and weeks after the release of the cupbearer, be thinking any moment now, I should start to pack my things. I should start to make myself ready. I should start. And sometimes the anticipation of that you think is going to happen is enough to kill a person. Any moment now. Turn into 6 months, into 12 months, into 18 months, and into 2 years. Imagine how you will be feeling. Imagine how you will be feeling. Someone wrote this. You have been misunderstood. You have sown seeds of holiness and love to reap nothing but disappointment, loss, suffering, and hate. You know something of what Joseph felt in that wretched dungeon hole. Waiting. How did Joseph endure this without losing faith in God? How did he avoid the conclusion that God wasn't toying with him, raising his hopes only to crush them? How did he keep from becoming a bitter, vengeful, angry man as he faced the prospect of dying in a dungeon in a foreign land. But today I say to us, today I say to myself, stay focused when it all goes wrong. Stay focused. Keep the conviction that God's reign over all the details of our lives, from the greatest to from the biggest to the smallest. Keep the conviction. Keep the conviction. And when we think about brothers and our sisters, in so-called third world countries, in Middle East, in Africa, in Far East, serving God faithfully every day, but are still persecuted. I have known and I have seen people sleeping in their churches so that they would not burn the churches down. We have the luxury of being able to assemble anywhere, anytime we want, without anyone raising an eyebrow. I have known people that cannot worship God freely unless they go to their country's embassy. We can get on top of the roof of our house and shout hallelujah, and nobody's going to care. How do they sustain their faith in God? How do they sustain their faith in God? And for us, I know I'm not disputing or I'm not belittling the challenges that we face as children of God in this country, in this community, in this nation, in the Western world. Ridiculous, I know. You cannot wear a cross to the workplace in some places. You cannot speak about the gospel to your work colleagues. I know. How do we sustain our faith? Those who suffered for their testimony never once expressed any sense that God is limited in what he has control over. God has control over everything. Today, when things go wrong, God wouldn't have willed that sickness or that explosion or that wreck. Someone asked not too long ago, if God is alive, why do we see all the bombings, all the accidents that you see all around? Why do small children die? But all men and women of faith, Joseph, Paul, And I'm sure if we cast our mind to recent histories, ordinary men and women like us sitting here, have not expressed any sense that God is limited. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22, the Bible says, flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. All through Joseph's experience, there was no indication that he followed through the line of thinking, where is God in all of this? Romans 8, chapter 28. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose. And Job 12 said this, verse 13, to God belong wisdom and power, counsel and understanding are his. What he tears down cannot be rebuilt. Those he imprisons cannot be released. If he holds back the waters, there is drought. If he lets them loose, they devastate the land. To him belong strength and insight. Both deceived and deceiver are his. Let's rest on the assurance that he is alive. Rest there. Stay there. Joseph did. David did. This is the place of comfort. This is the place of endurance. This is the place of hope. Let your disillusionment with what is happening to you turn to the goodness and faithfulness of the Lord. Throughout his history, his short life, Joseph learned that there will be disappointments along the way. God never said at any point in time that if you serve me, when you serve me, it's going to be trouble-free. What we do know, though, that in every situation, he will be there, present, and walking alongside us. He will be holding us. People are going to fail you. They are going to disappoint you. They are going to leave you hanging dry. But let God take control. Let God take control. Jeremiah chapter 17 said this. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. He is like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream, does not fear when heat comes, for its leaves remain green, and is not anxious in the year of drought, for it does not cease to bear fruit. We need to learn to wait upon the Lord. Joseph did, and in one day, he moved from being a prisoner to being the prime minister. Hallelujah. In one day, because God was at work in his situation, he relied on God to take hold of what was happening to him. Wait upon the Lord. Isaiah knew well this truth, and he gave us these great words. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall soar on wings as eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall run and not be faint. Joseph understood that God's way are not our ways. His timing is always perfect. Right from the time he was born, God was at work. He didn't know it. His brothers didn't know it. His father didn't know it. But God was at work in every situation, in the good and in the bad, in the ugly, in the good times and the bad times. God was at work. His timing is always perfect. Ruth Calkin wrote this poem. Today, Lord, I have an unshakable conviction, a positive, resolute assurance that what you have spoken is true. But today, Lord, my sick body feels stronger, and the stumping pain quietly subsides. Tomorrow, if I must struggle again with aching exhaustion, with twisting pain, until I am breathless, until I am utterly spent, until fear eclipses the last vestige of hope, then, Lord, then grant me the enabling grace to believe without feeling, to know without seeing, to clasp your invisible hand and wait with the invisible trust for the morning. That is what I want to leave with us this afternoon. And I want you to know that he knows. When you are hard-pressed on every side, he knows. When you are perplexed, he knows. When you are persecuted, he knows. When you are struck down, he knows. So stand firm. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 8 to 9, said, we are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. Stand firm, because he knows. And if you think that what you're thinking, God doesn't know. I was recently struggling with something, with an issue. And I was contemplating various options, looking at various things. And I was sat just minding my own business, thinking I had got everything sourced. Thinking, yes, that is right. That sounds rational to me. And then out of nowhere, I was directed to read the passage I read at the beginning. Psalm 139. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word, that's the one that actually got me. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in, behind, and before. And you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as a light to you. For you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts. God, how vast is the sum of them. So as we go out this morning, or this afternoon rather, I implore you to stand firm. When the challenges of life come, as they came to Joseph, stand firm, because he knows and is at work. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the work of grace. We thank you for the comfort of knowing that you know everything about us, about our lives, about our situation. We thank you for the assurance of that grace, the grace that comes from knowing you and being your children. Lord in heaven, we have individually, we have things in our lives, some that are too heavy for our shoulders. Father, we pray this afternoon by your grace that you meet each and every one of us at a point of needs, Lord. We pray, Father in heaven, that your grace, your power, your authority, and your anointing that surpass any human understanding will be at work in our lives. We pray for release. Release of the abundance of your grace into our lives and into our situations. And Lord, we pray that in all things that we do, your light will shine in us and through us for your grace, for your praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.